will move my presentation according to the shape of Italy. This is the map of Italy. We will begin from Rome, the capital. Then we are going to go in the north of Italy, and then we are descending again to the south. I don't know how many of you have been in Rome, but if you've been there, you might recognize some of the monuments here. The biggest one being the Altar della Patria, which means the Altar of the Fatherland. It was built not by the Romans, even though it's so classic in the architecture, it's neoclassic. It was built in the 19th century, in the end of the 19th, and they needed 40 years to build it. It contains the body of the unknown soldier, which was a random dead soldier that they found and died in the First World War. And it represents all the dead for the First World War. And this is one of the most representative pieces of Rome. The other one being the Fountain of Trevi, which is very common to see around, and it became immortal when they put it in a movie called La Dolce Vita, which was very influential by Federico Fellini in the 1960. For example, if you go in Dopo Square here in Eger, you can find a bar called Café Dolce Vita. Dolce Vita means this. It's a reference to the movie. Every country knows this movie. And we talk, you study cinema, Italia, Dolce Vita, Fellini, yes, of course, Dolce Vita. 20 years later. Many of the monuments in Rome were built by the Romans. Guess what? And of course, this is the Colosseum, built in the 80 Anno Domini, 80. They needed 6 years to build it. So one may ask, why did they need 6 years to build the Colosseum 2,000 years ago, and they needed 40 years to build the Altar of the Fatherland? Who knows? We are very slow to build things, we Italians. Another thing that the Romans built was the Pantheon, 50 years later than the Colosseum. It was a temple dedicated to all the past, present, and future gods. It would be very modern and interesting as a concept if it wasn't that in the 7th century it became a church. It was acquired by the church and became an actual church. So it's not a temple dedicated to all gods anymore, it's just a temple dedicated to the Christian God. And there are many churches in Rome. There are 900 churches in Rome and 32,000 churches in all Italy. And the most important one is the Basilica of San Pietro that you see behind me. Actually, it's in the background. It's probably the most important church of all because it's the place of the Christian religion. And all this square in front of it is the San Pietro Square. Now, what you see is not Italy. This is the Vatican State. It's different. It's another country. It has its own laws, its own police, its own rules, and it's like that since the signing of these documents. This is the signature of the Lateranense Pact, or the Laterano Pact, which means the pact signed in the Laterano Palace. On the right side there is Mussolini, and on the other side there is the equivalent of the Prime Minister of the Vatican State, which is the Cardinal Secretary of State, Pietro Gasparri. They were sending these documents through which the Church supported Mussolini dictatorship while he was granting them the Vatican State as their own country. And plus, he made Christianity the state religion. So from that moment on, they teach religion in school, from primary school to high school. It's possible to avoid it, but it's a pain because you have to ask for it. There is a lot of bureaucracy for it. So, after this, they made even more churches, and for example, this is another church in Rome, Basilica of Santa Apollinare. It's not so famous and it's not so beautiful, but it became quite notorious because between the 54 and the 90, it held the remains of this person, which was called Enrico de Pedis. Now, Enrico de Pedis was not a politician, he was not a religious head, he was the head of the Banda della Magliana. Banda della Magliana was a mafia organization that during the second half of the 70s was able to control all the criminal world of Rome, which up to that point was a mess. They were all divided. And they operated in businesses such as kidnapping, gambling, robberies, drug dealing, and had relations to the Italian secret services. So the head of this person was buried in a church. And you may guess if they all are in jail in this moment, but you don't see it well here. There is this person. This is a contemporary photo of him. He lacks one eye because of a shooting with police. His name is Massimo Carminati, and he was a terrorist affiliated with NARC, which means Nucleo Armato Rivoluzionario, which means Armored Revolutionary Corps. It was a terrorist group of extreme right, and he finally went in jail only last year, because they found out him to be that of another organization called Mafia Capitale, which was more or less the same thing as the previous group that you already saw, and they occupied themselves with extortion, usury, bribery, and tax evasions. So, they needed 30 years to put him in jail, again, because sometimes he comes out and it happens. Let's move on to another place of Italy. That's the north. And I'm going to talk in particular about Genova. Genova is the most important port in Italy. It's the most important port in Italy, and it's also one of the most important ports in all Europe, in particular on the Mediterranean area. It's like that since the medieval times, together with Venice, it was the one of the two most important ports, but now it won this business war, so it's the most important one. And it became important also in the international relations in 2001, when in July it held it guested the G8. Now the G8, I don't know if everybody knows it, it's a political economic forum among several countries, these ones. Move on, okay. And during those days, between the 19th and 22th of July in Genova, there were a lot of tension, which led to several enormous demonstrations and street protests that escalated up to fights with the police. And this is what you see at my back. And in one of those fights, there was also a protester that died. This happened, but what happened more is that the police made a very violent search inside a school called Diaz, and also in another school, in which 93 people were sleeping, and they had the permission for that. And they beat down every one of them so badly that one of them also went in coma for 2 days. And there are videos that shows that there were no reasons for that. So they were processed. There were 250 prosecutions after the facts of the G8 in Genova. And the final turning point of this was last year, when in 2015 the European Court of Human Rights condemned Italy for the violation of the third article in the European Convention of Human Rights relevant to torture and to conditions and punishments degrading and inhuman. So basically Italy was condemned for having tortured 93 people. And we had to pay a fine for that, I think. And in the north there are also the Alps. The most representative place maybe are the Dolomiti. These ones there, of course, they are a paradise for skiers, snowboarders and rock climbers. And in the east, you can see it. It's fine. So there is a lake, more or less in the middle. And that's the Lake of Garda. I found some people here, which I don't see in this room, which told me that this is the best place in Italy. And many people think so, because, for example, George Clooney has a house near, on the Lake of Garda. But I think that in this area, my favorite place is this one. This one is the Lake of Resia. It's very interesting because there was a town beneath it. And it was evacuated to make space for an artificial lake. This lake is artificial, it's full of fishes, but it's artificial. And they did it because in the 60s and 70s it was very typical to build artificial lakes, to make them and to produce electricity. And the most famous dam is this one. The dam of the Vaillant. Vaillant means it goes down in the dialect of that region, in the popular language. And you can see from the back that the mountain is actually full of avalanches. I mean, the ground is not stable. So everybody knew that you couldn't make a dam there, but there were also scientific articles and studies that show that you couldn't build a dam. And they were able to hide those articles and to ignore them, and they built the dam anyway. Now, what you don't see in this photo is that there isn't any water behind it. It's full of dirt. Because when they finished it, and they were filling it with water, the mountain came down, like everybody knew. So there was a sort of tsunami. The mountain went down, the water came out, and in front of this place, there was a village called Longarone, and this is the village the day after. and there were 1,917 dead. And the damage was estimated to be in 900 billions of liras, which converted to today's euros are over 10 billions euros. And this is a very Italian story, I mean, they talk about it in television. And moving away, there is Milano. Milano maybe is the most modern city of Italy, and it can be considered also to be the biggest one for some statistics. This is the skyline, and there are many monuments around, like the Duomo, very big church, you can go on the roof. Also, I think that you see the Duomo in La Dolce Vita, but maybe I'm not sure about this. This is the Parco Sempione, an enormous and very beautiful park near the castle that you don't see because it's on this side, the castle, so you can see it. But if you know soccer, maybe you know the Stadium of San Siro, which is the stadium, I think, of Milan. But what you maybe don't know about Milan is that the owner of Milan is Silvio Berlusconi. And so Milan is part of the holding company of Silvio Berlusconi, which is called Fininvest. Now, Fininvest is the name of this company, and through it, Berlusconi was involved in a series of operations that made him one of the most of the richest men in the world. But at the same time, he was also prosecuted more than 20 times for things like tax fraud, false accounting, bribery, illegal financing of political parties, false testimony, underage prostitution for real, tax evasion, slaughter contribution, and in the end, external relationship in mafia association. Now you can guess why he's not in jail. Well, while he was at the government, he was able to change the rules 6 times to change the details of the crimes he was charged of. So in the end, he never went to jail. But if you want to the details, just go on Wikipedia and check this page. And there is also the English version of it. And you can see the size of this page. Okay, look at the scroll bar. And in the end, it was charged just one time, but with a following process, they got away the conviction. So let's leave Milan. And we go to the Pianura Padana. Pianura Padana means Padana plain. And it's the biggest and only, actually, plain in Italy. So even though it's not that big on a European scale, it's very important for us, so it's covered of farms. Actually, these photos are from the hills near the Padana plain. You can see in the distance how it is. This is the situation. They produce a lot of wine. There are many industries. And this is interesting because this photo was taken in summer for sure. Because if you go there in spring, autumn, or winter, this is more likely the weather that you find. Fog. 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 And believe me, this is normal. I mean, here you can't see anything, okay, but in the computer you can almost see this building. There is a building here, okay? And this is not the worst, because sometimes I open the window of my home and I don't see the other side of the road. Now, why there is the fog? Very easy. Because there are the mountains. The mountains are there and close the Padana plain, so there is no wind. There is a lot of wet air, and the air doesn't go away. So, of course, this is beautiful. But there is another problem connected to this. This is